Good afternoon to you. Mark Sutt of HurricaneTrack.com here with your hurricane outlook and discussion for Monday, July the 18th, 2016. In the Atlantic Basin, nothing happening over the next 24, 48, 120 hours, whatever. Going to be quiet for a while. Maybe another month. Wouldn't surprise me, and it's perfectly normal. Looking at climatology, not going to go over that again, but you know, just thinking about it this time of year, into about mid-August, not much happens, and it might stay that way. In the eastern Pacific, boy, this is where it's been very busy the last several days. We have Hurricane Darby getting ready to weaken to a tropical storm over cooler water. Then we have Estelle, likely to be a hurricane at some point, and then something will develop out of this to eventually become Frank. And if we look at the track map for Darby, yes, it looks like it's headed towards Hawaii, but no worries because this is going to weaken to a tropical storm, and the low-level swirl that's the leftovers of that, that might make its way towards the String of Pearls out here, bringing an additional shower or two, maybe an increase in the surf out that way, but that's about it. The track for Estelle, over the open Pacific still, no worries out here at all. Probably not going to become a major hurricane either, so really not much of a threat of swells coming in to the coast of the Baja or Southern California. Maybe a little bit of additional swell action, but the Pacific, very large body of water, as you well know, and it already has a lot of energy put into it from other storms all around that basin. And so these hurricanes, unless they are really intense, typically don't add much to the background noise of the overall swell pattern unless they are, as I said, very intense. Now, looking at the satellite picture, this is from the University of Wisconsin. I really like this one. You can see the leftovers of Celia here, just a remnant post-tropical circulation. Here is Darby, and again, it's going to move along and then weaken as it turns more to the south. High pressure out here. Once this gets reduced to just a low-level swirl, then it's more than likely just going to follow the trade wind pattern out there. Here is larger Estelle, and again, very lucky that Mexico has gone without any of these systems affecting them. We've had high pressure in place out here, keeping these systems offshore. And you can see also sort of this grapevine and incubator of these systems, and we have more energy trying to amass here south of the Gulf of Tehuantepec. So it won't surprise me at all if we see Frank and then the maybe G and H storm. Probably going to set a record before July is over out in this area. And as long as nothing impacts Mexico or Hawaii, so be it. But as I'm going to show you, there's potentially a little bit of a problem lurking because of all this activity out there. I'll show you that in a moment. An interesting analysis feature, the low-level convergence. Again, an analysis tool from the University of Wisconsin. You can see pretty good convergence still down in the southeast Pacific. What does that mean? Basically, this is showing where the air is coming together at the lower levels, converging, and when it does that, it's able to sort of force the atmosphere to react, and you get these tropical cyclones popping out of this grapevine, so to speak. And you can see that a lot better here on the precipitable water animation over the last 72 hours. This is really fascinating to me. I really like it. First, you can see the very stable air mass over the northern Pacific outside of the tropics, and you can see the dwindling circulation of Celia, the soon-to-be dwindling circulation of Darby, and there is Estelle. And then notice here, here's that convergence I was talking about. You can really see the moisture here coming in and converging along this line through here, this grapevine, as I like to call it. And every once in a while, you get this energy that rolls in and it spins off another storm. Pretty fascinating to see, at least I think it is. And eventually, this will happen in the Atlantic. It's just a matter of time. Right now, it is the Eastern Pacific's turn and is taking advantage of that fully. All right, let's move along now. Looking at sea surface temperature anomalies, here it is for today, July the 18th, and you can see cooling in the extreme eastern Pacific. Definitely do not have much in the way of positive anomalies in the extreme eastern Pacific. And then along the equatorial region here, the Niño 3.4 area, the coldest that it's been in quite some time. as water is upwelling out in that area, cold water lurking below the surface. We'll take a look at that in a moment. Notice, too, fairly warm in the Atlantic MDR. Caribbean Gulf, just ridiculously warm compared to normal. And the Western Atlantic here, especially off the east and southeast coast, very warm compared to where it should be. And we're getting to the point now where this is going to become a problem if we get a hurricane running through that very warm water. It's undisturbed, very warm, and that could be problematic. I'm going to show you a different comparison of that in just a moment in a deeper analysis. So this is the subsurface anomaly, and you can see in the eastern Pacific, cold, a few positive anomalies in the western Pacific, but overall the subsurface water indicative of the La Nina that's trying to develop. And it won't be long now, maybe another couple of months, that it'll officially get named La Nina, maybe weak La Nina conditions. One thing is for absolute certain, you can see here, at least in the eastern half of the tropical Pacific, cold water abounds, a stark difference to this time last year. So this is the upper ocean heat content map that I've been showing recently. TCHP also is the other way to look at it, tropical cyclone heat potential. Generally anything in the upper part of the scale, very, very warm, deep water for tropical cyclones to take advantage of. And you can see right off the southeast coast here, this is very, very warm. I don't recall that I've seen it this warm so early in the season. Obviously very high ocean heat content here in the Caribbean, almost at the top of the scale. And then the Gulf is very, very warm as well. And I want to show you something. This is what it looked like not on today's date, but at the virtual peak of the season, in the record season to end all seasons, was 05. So this is what it looked like at what should be the warmest time of the year, the peak of the season, in 2005, when we had 28 named storms. And this is what it looks like today. So let me just go back and forth a little bit. You notice a couple of things. First of all, it's definitely warmer and more ocean heat content now than we had back in 2005. That's clear. But you can also see that the bulk of the warmth this year has shifted south and west this way more so than it was in 05. In 2005, we had a lot of warm water out in the open Atlantic and into the MDR, which really didn't matter because our big hurricanes that hit the U.S. that year all developed fully pretty much west of 70. Think about Katrina, came in like this. Rita didn't really get going until the open Gulf here. And then, of course, Wilma came in after hitting the Yucatan. We did not have a Cape Verde hurricane come all the way across and hit somebody in the United States in 2005. So it kind of didn't matter that the Atlantic was very warm. But this year, all of this very, very warm deep ocean water, the upper ocean heat content being so high, shifted to the west and south like this. I tell you, when something comes along, and you know, yes, it's mathematically possible that nothing will happen, but I just think that it's only a matter of time that something will. And I'm telling you, just looking at this, very warm ocean temperatures await. And if we look at the actual analysis, to me, this is very, very, not shocking, but it's an eye-opener. And what is that? Well, check it out. There's the 29 degrees Celsius isotherm all the way up to the north of 38 degrees longitude now. That is absolutely incredible. Let me get rid of one of these animations in here, which is bogging down my computer. There we go. The 29 degree isotherm way up here in the northern Atlantic, that's problematic if something were to come along. The 26 degree isotherm, which is roughly the temperature needed to even get development, that's creeping north as well. It's just very warm along the Gulf Stream and off the southeast coast. 30 degrees Celsius, yep, right there, right off of North Carolina. I tell you, we better hope nothing comes along and taps this, because it is very warm, to say the least. And it can change in a heartbeat if we get a lot of westerly winds and cold fronts coming through here, mixing all of this up, or if we get a hurricane offshore. But for now, this is sitting there waiting like hurricane bait, if you will. And again, not trying to be alarmist, I'm just showing you the facts. and we know what that warm water can do. In the Gulf of Mexico, all of this green, 30 degrees Celsius and higher, shelf water here along Florida's west coast and just off of Apalachicola, 31 degrees Celsius, ridiculous. Very, very warm. I've been over this enough. You get the idea that, yep, there's some very warm water waiting, and you know we still have about a month to go until the peak of the season really begins. So what's happening? Why don't we have anything in the Atlantic right now to tap into that water? Well, that certainly is a good thing for coastal residents, for sure. Wind shear really not a problem overall. It's definitely dropped, especially out here in the tropical Atlantic. 5-10 knots, that's about it. But generally, cyclonic flow in the atmosphere, sort of this large upper tropospheric trough kind of pattern, cyclonic coming together air convergence in the upper levels, not good for development. We don't have any large-scale areas of rising motion, and where we do, down here in the deep tropics, we've got very dry air in the mid and lower levels, and that's putting a damper on things. Contrast that to the eastern Pacific. So here's the west coast of the United States, there's the Baja, and there's Mexico, and check it out. All through here, you have sort of this, you know, I talked about the grapevine. Well, look, there's these little cells of upper-level anticyclonic flow and divergence in the atmosphere where the air is spreading out very evenly. You don't have wind coming across the top or anything like that. Very favorable conditions out here in somewhat of a narrow area, but it's enough that the wind shear, you know, and the upper atmosphere together are coupling to allow stuff to develop. If we go back to this other map one more time, you look at that contrast here. This is just all cyclonic flow. So once this flips in the Atlantic, then we will begin to see stuff develop. And I talked about that this area, wind shear, not a problem in the deep tropics, but this dry Saharan air intrusion is. And again, it's July 18th. Pressures are typically high out there. This is no surprise at all. But you know what? We do have these large tropical waves, areas of convection over Africa that are moving westward, and they will continue to moisten up the atmosphere, and the pressures will slowly lower out in this region, and the Saharan air will come off farther to the north, and this will start to open up for something to develop eventually. And I tell you, people had better be ready, because with those warm temperatures waiting in the western Atlantic, it could be a nasty surprise later in the season. All right, this week, as I showed in the 2005 TCHP map, figured I would take a look again at Hurricane Emily, at this week in hurricane history, part of a very busy and historic 05 season. Remember, Emily got its start way out here in the MDR, but it didn't hit the U.S., so you know I don't count that. Plus, it really didn't become a hurricane until farther to the west. And then it was a Category 5 just to the south and west of Jamaica, making landfall along the Yucatan Peninsula. And then it strengthened again right before making landfall here just south of Brownsville. Satellite picture before it made landfall along the Yucatan here. You can see that very small core. And that was a big part of Emily's legacy, I guess you could say. It wasn't a large and sprawling hurricane, but very intense around a very small core, tiny little eye there, making landfall along the Yucatan, and then eventually making its way just to the south of South Padre Island in Brownsville, Texas, which is just inland here. And you can see it had sort of a double wind maxima, one wind maxima there, and then a tighter wind maxima near the eye, and it barreled on inland here and died out over northern Mexico. And that was pretty much it until later. It was about a month later that the really big hurricanes that hit the United States began to form. Katrina about a month later towards the end of August, and then about every 2 weeks thereafter another large dangerous hurricane developed in the western Atlantic basin. So even in a very busy year like 05, we had these spurts where we didn't have much activity, sort of these ragged storms here and there interspersed with something like an Emily, and then you had about a month, and then there was Katrina, and then towards the end of September there was Rita, and then the end of October there was Wilma. Sort of these pulses making up the 05 season with sort of trash storms sprinkled in between that just roamed the Atlantic, adding up those ace points and the eventual total of 28 named storms before it was all said and done. All right, so just to recap here, the bottom line, Eastern Pacific staying busy. Once that dies down, I think the Atlantic will have a chance to get going. But, you know, again, it's not going to surprise me in the least if it's not until later August that things get going. And then I think once they do, I think the warning here is look at what's happening in the Pacific. That once the Atlantic starts, it won't stop until it's all said and done. That's my theory. We'll see if I'm right. Until then, be safe out there. Have a good rest of the week ahead. I'm going to take a few days off. There's really not much else to talk about. All these fish storms in the Pacific. If there's any threats, I will certainly be back. Otherwise, let's talk again on Friday, shall we? Very good. So have a good rest of the week between now and then. I am Mark Suddeth for HurricaneTrack.com. As always, thanks for tuning in. Hope you learned something today. And I'll talk to you again towards the end of the week.